The debate's on. Do I have to watch it? Hillary, just shut up. This is a non-issue, unless you turn it into one. Nobody thinks Hillary is an honest, credible candidate. Her numbers are not going to move by attacking her character. It's like accusing a lion of being a carnivore. You might not like carnivores, but you understand a lion is for what it is. Or maybe to use a more apt metaphor, it's like accusing a lion of having spots. You shouldn't, sorry, accusing a leopard of having spots. Lions don't have spots. Maybe if you took a hybrid between a lion and a leopard, it might have spots. But lions don't have spots. Or at least we don't think they have spots. Have you ever seen a shaved lion? How do you know that a lion doesn't have spots? But the leopard is the one with the spots. And if you can accuse a leopard of having spots, but you wouldn't expect a leopard to change its spots. Nor would you think particularly bad of a leopard for having spots. It's a leopard. Leopards have spots. You know, you can imagine the leopard looking back at it and saying, what am I going to do? I'm a leopard. But the more she talks, the more she opens herself up to things that might convince people not to vote for her. Like that she's stuck in the fucking Cold War. She can't talk her way out of this. She doesn't need to. This being the WikiLeaks things. She should look the camera in the eye and state that politics is messy. That's a pragmatic, realistic position. Again, everybody knows she's dishonest. Everybody knows he's dishonest, too. So, you know, if you don't want to vote for somebody that's dishonest, there's no answer on the other side. I've been over this a bunch of times. You know, it's... She got the best candidate she could possibly get. Because everything you could possibly hit her on, he's worse. Except foreign policy. But Americans don't vote on foreign policy. So, you know. Everybody knows she supports the TPP. She tells us she's not, we all know that she does. But he's going to support the TPP too. He tells us he doesn't, but he will. Everybody knows she supports Keystone. He doesn't even pretend he doesn't support Keystone. These really aren't issues. There's a link to a Swans video here. But I believe it's David Hicks. Is it David Hicks? Is that the right first name? Let me verify that. I'm getting a brain freeze on that one. Yeah. No. Okay. Just a second here. I don't think it's David Hicks. David Hicks is a terrorist from Australia. Are you like a terrorist? You're too white to be a terrorist. This is a Hicks that was... It's Bill Hicks, okay. That's right. Both Tool and Swans have used Bill Hicks material. And I do believe that that's who that is in the song. Dead guy now. For quite a while, actually, huh? Let me fix that a bit. Yeah. Dead a long time. I guess I got a little bit of mental. My subconscious is at work or something. Something plays David Hicks in my mind. I can't even recall the story. Somebody says, I mean, I see that David Hicks is a terrorist from Australia. I couldn't tell you more than that about David Hicks. And yet, it's David Hicks that jumps over into my mind and not the correct Bill Hicks. It's just a song that reminded me of the scenario. Prisoner in the Skull. The prisoner in the skull. But how we're all fucked up. She's more fucked up than him. And some time went by, and I decided that I couldn't watch it. And I didn't watch it. I turned it off. I did not watch the debate. She's a warmonger, and he's a retard. I watched something like 25 minutes of it. Tuned in late, turned it off early. It was revolting to me. So file me under disgusted, and don't expect me to analyze it further. And I'm going to hold to that. I'm not going to analyze this debate. They're both horrible. What would I do in Syria? I would immediately halt all support to the rebels, who are in no way moderate, as they could not survive without it. I would then negotiate with the Russians to stop the bombing and provide a tactical assistance to the Syrian police in rounding up any remaining moderate terrorists. And we wouldn't go through this Assad doesn't have legitimacy thing. It's not up to us to decide if Assad has legitimacy. It's up to the people of Syria to decide if Assad has legitimacy. And the people of Syria have been very clear that Assad has legitimacy. Not according to me, that's according to the Syrian people. And it's the Syrian people that get to make that choice. So let's stop funding the terrorists in Syria and let the cops there deal with it. This is not a solution that I like. It's the only solution that exists. Okay? Anything else is decades of war. You want to fight this war for the next 20 years? Because that's what's going to happen. They will never defeat the Russians. I mean, the other option is, do you want to start a war with Russia? You want a hot war with the Russians? This is a stupid position. The Americans, and by extension NATO, us, we need to acknowledge that we're in a stupid position. Retreat. And go do something more productive. I'm sorry to be flippant, but it's the truth of it, okay? I would continue to fund NGOs that seek a peaceful transfer of power in Syria. Which probably wouldn't be so hard if we took away their fucking guns. I don't think that Assad is particularly well-loved in the region. But if the choice is between Assad, which is a secular, you know, social democratic state, and it is. Hey, you want to know something, guys? Syria has a universal healthcare system. And you think they're the third world? They don't have a lot of freedom of expression, but it's not such a terrible place to live, unless you get off on criticizing the government. It's a secular society with a lot of social rights. I can think of a lot of worse places to live, including the United States. So when the Syrian people pick that over a bunch of fucking terrorists that are operating with jihadis and want to enforce religious laws on them, I'm not going to support the fucking jihadis that want to push down religious laws. I'm going to support the modern, secular, social state. I'm trying to avoid the word democracy because it's... Well, I mean it. Do you think you live in a democracy? But nonetheless. If you take away the guns from these assholes, of course you're not going to support them. How do you prevent a movement? It's the same thing in the United States, right? How do you prevent protesters from getting anywhere in the United States? Is you accuse them of violence. We all know this. Ask a free trade protester. And then the media runs stories about how the protesters are violent. And then they say, well, it was the cops. And it probably was. But why was it the cops? Because they want to tar the protesters. They want to say they're violent. Because we know that as soon as the protesters are thought of as violent, the majority will not support them. And this is the same fucking thing there. If you want to have a revolution in Syria, the first thing you should do is you should stop funding the people with the guns. And you should start funding the people with the flowers. I'm not really big into policing. And if I thought that this uprising, which is in fact a foreign-backed group of militants, if I thought there was any good potential in it, then I would not be proposing this course of action. But I realize that these are a bunch of no-goodniks. And the best thing to do with them is to take them out. It would help the Syrian police take them out. And then I would work with the Russians to take out ISIS. I would not talk about setting up a no-fly zone. That would be perpetuating a proxy war in a geopolitical struggle with the Russians that I demand immediately stops. I would also spend trillions and trillions and trillions of dollars to transfer off of carbon, which will end our alliance with the fucking Saudis, which is what is driving this mess. Fuck the Saudis. No more selling things to the Saudis. No more cooperating with the Saudis. Absolute, total, permanent boycott on the Saudis. And lastly, I would construct an international coalition to institute regime change in Saudi Arabia and end this fucking catastrophe once and for all. I would stop bombing Syria and start bombing the Saudis. Because that's where the problem is. Are you still confused as to why I don't want to vote for her? Even though I insist that you must. And I know that you're going to look at it and you're going to say, geez, isn't that what Trump says? Well, maybe. It doesn't really matter. Because it doesn't mean anything. He'll wake up tomorrow and tell you to change his mind. Right? And even so, he's not the guy I want in charge of this, okay? This is a difficult thing to do, okay? You have to completely switch alliances. You've got to make sure that when you're aligning with the Russians, you don't let them take advantage of you. He's too incompetent to follow through with it. You don't want him doing it. But I have been clear from the start that if Trump does have an upside, it is with his foreign policy. Everything else he says is stupid. Okay? His economic policies are ridiculous. His fiscal policies are absurd. His social policies are frightening. But his foreign policy is actually, I think, a little bit better. Like, I have not been shy about that. If the election was solely about foreign policy and nothing else, I would endorse Trump. But it's not. And he's an idiot. Yes, I understand that the actual policy in the region is divide and conquer. Set the barbarians against each other and steal their shit. The old Roman tactic, I've been over this repeatedly. Watch my vids. It's all over them. It doesn't mean I have to support it. She just pissed me right off. I'm watching the debate and she goes off on her Syrian plan and I just snapped. I turned it off, never turned it back on, haven't watched it yet, not going to watch it. But you do still have to vote for her. It took 18 years and multiple attempts at a construction, but this record is finally permanently completed as an instrumental electronic work, and I am finally proud to refer to it as my first record. While most of these songs have defined concepts underlying them, I have ejected these concepts from the final recording and left them in a series of singles. I would prefer that this album be understood solely as the instrumental recording of electronic music that I am presenting it as. That is my first record, inri015. Done. It's 8 o'clock in the morning already. And in fact, I've been up since, I crashed early yesterday. I crashed at like 1:30 in the afternoon. And I've been up since like 9 o'clock at night. We've got some good news regarding this. Well, first of all, that's my printer. Have we printed anything yet? I don't think so. It's just a cheap Epson printer. It works though. That's what I need. I'm a little bit concerned that, well, this is the first time that I'm going past the, starter. I replaced the black ink. I haven't replaced any of the other inks. So I don't know if I'm going to have enough to actually finish the printing process or not. We're going to find out. I'm going to do the discs first. I have closed 14 and 15. I have printed two CDs with 14. Sorry, two CDs of 15. One of them's here. That's the one I'm shipping. And I made one for myself. Whenever I ship a disc for the first time, I make it for myself. So, yeah, we're going to talk about the close later, but we're doing the printing process here, and we'll get back to this in a bit. But yeah, I've been up 12 hours already. What did I do all morning? It's I closed the discs, I did the cover art. The cover art's done. It's closed completely. I got to print it, mail it in the morning. I also need to eat. I haven't eaten yet today, so. Not a really exciting morning, but at least that, we're gonna have the talk soon, right? We'll do the close soon, we'll have the talk soon, and we'll go from there. Well, looks like we've got enough ink, here, which is good. We're just gonna let this dry. I've got, I tried with a few different types of paper, because I'm not sure. I haven't printed a lot of CDs, and I'm still kind of just not sure what the best way to do it is. I'll probably eventually just like go down to the store and get like the right kind of paper, but right now I've got a couple different kinds of paper, so I tried a couple different kinds of paper. In fact, this paper is very old. This paper's as old as the record is. This paper's 20 years old. Believe it or not, I have 20-year-old paper. 18 years old anyways. I got enough ink, like I say, so we're gonna let it dry. We'll come back to it. I'm sure one of these will be good enough to ship, and the other one will go to the person I can leave here. So we're gonna go ahead and power that off, and let's get something to eat because I'm hungry. By the time I'm done eating, I suppose that I'll be ready to cut up and ready to go. So I'm gonna need to do a little bit of shopping. Something else I'm gonna need to do. Well, the caddywhompus show is tonight. I'm going to at some point probably need to get a little nap. I'm also going to want to, I need to figure out today if I'm going to Touche morning or not. It's, the bus is going to be more than I wanted. But I mean, like, what am I going to do with that? Like, let's say I spend $50 more than I wanted to. What am I going to do with that? The money comes in every month. You know, like, it might seem like it's a little bit expensive, but so what, kind of thing, right? Like, what else am I going to do with it, right? So, I just need to make sure that I can, right? Check the budget, make sure everything's working out okay, and if it is, I'm gonna go ahead and do it. I can pick up the tickets at, I can pick them up at 7-Eleven, and I ideally like to do it tonight, so yeah, I mean, yeah, like, I'll cross over, I'll pick the tickets up at the 7-Eleven, and then I'll go to the show, right? So, I need to listen to it a few more times, just to be sure. It's not even really the listening thing, it's more like the budgeting thing, right? I don't want to go and do it, and then, at the end of it, realize, wait a second, you know, I don't have enough money to buy my pills or something at the end of the month, right? So, I gotta do that, so, I'm kind of not really expecting anything else to show up, and there's not really. The truth is that, like, if of all of the bands I've been listening to over the last 5 or 6 years, Touche Amore are pretty close and near the top of it. I did see them once. It was in 2011. I saw them with La Dispute. Surprise, surprise! I saw Touche Amore with La Dispute. Right. Anyways, it was in Ottawa. They were touring. I guess it was their first record. I've missed them on the last two tours just because of the border issue, right? So, the last time they came around here, I didn't get a chance to see them. And Like they played some like big rock festival or something not very far from here, and I don't want to pay, you know, $150 to go. I mean, I'm too old for that. I'm not going to enjoy 80% of the bands. The truth is, I'm not going to enjoy 95% of the bands there. It was like rock, some kind of festival that was like Warped, and I'm too old to go to something like that, right? It's not my thing. And I mean, even, I think Touche Amore has done Warped, and they don't compare well. It's maybe a sad reflection on Warped. But you know, you look at the bands that they get there, and it's just like, you know, corporate, like this big long list of like corporate emo bands, and there's Touche Amore, which is like kind of like a real hardcore band, right? So like, I've missed them a bunch of times, and I kind of would like to see them again. So I mean, it's a very high chance that it's just like, to make sure I can. That's kind of the thing, right? So anyway, let's get something to eat. I'm making eggs. I'm hungry. In fact, by the time I get the eggs going, I should be able to. I want to listen to it, right? Listen to one of them before I ship, because I haven't. That's something I have not done. Is I have not listened to the record through a CD, through a CD player. So I will do that as well. I just have to cut it up and paste it up, right? So it's like, in fact, I'm not stapling, I'm not pasting. I just need to cut it and put it in, right? So. That'll be shipped by noon. I'm gonna have to take a brief stop to the grocery store, be back, and then I'm out. Like I said, I'm gonna want to get like an hour or two of like a nap kind of thing. But ultimately, this is why I drink alcohol with caffeine in it. It's gonna be a good show. I'm not gonna miss it. I just gotta get my ass going. But yeah, that's done. We're also gonna need to, of course. Well, I might be a little bit too, I might need to wait till tomorrow to do the, close on this. Anyways, I'm hungry. I just finished listening to this, and, I'm happy about this. Hey, I just listened to my first record on a CD, completely instrumental. I'm actually kind of stoked about it. I've been waiting 20 years to do that. 18 anyways. But I just kind of remembered as I was sitting there listening to it that I didn't number the disc. The whole point is that there's a number on the disc. So I have 2 0 copies. I was going to keep the 0 copy for myself anyways. I guess I got an extra promo. But I got to redo that. It's just like I've got to reburn the disc, reprint it, print some more cover art. How did this come out? How did this dry? I printed this on the wrong side. It's supposed to be like glossy, but it came out on the wrong side, and it's really not bad. This is more kind of like middle of the road paper. If I compare those two, you know, I'm not going to say one's worse than the other, to be honest with you. This is on the right side of the glossy paper, and it is a little bit more, granulated. So I'm thinking I'm probably gonna, let me cut that up and see. It probably actually will work out for the best. It's the same thing here. I think the back, this is on the wrong side and it's definitely grainy. This is on the right side and yeah, well look, it didn't, the ink isn't sitting right on this kind of paper. There's probably a setting I can do. This is, it's like the back. Is it dry even? Yeah, it's dry. It's not actually even dry. Yeah, look at that. See, I don't think it's going to dry. So, we're going to throw that away. And I'm thinking that we'll probably just use regular. Well, this isn't regular paper. It's a slight grade up. But, I mean, it's not the kind of glossy paper you'd expect from a high quality, I told you it's a CDR. It says right on the Bandcamp page that you can buy a CDR with a number on it. But I forgot to put a number on it, so I gotta put a number on it. I think that the front came out a little bit better. Yeah, I'm not sure. Is that dry? Yeah, this is a...
The back is going to be using regular paper. I'm pretty sure of that anyways.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no other way to read it. Just didn't want to come out, so. That's okay. Okay, let's get to doing it. Well, I gotta do that. So the glossy paper the right way is out. The reason the glossy paper the right way is out is that it's not drying. Maybe if I let it sit for like 2 days, it would dry. And if I try it again, that's what I'll do. But for right now, I mean, I want to ship this today. It's smudged up fairly badly. So we're just going to throw this away. Now, this is on the right side of the paper, right? I ended up with ink all over my hands. It was a big mess. So, in fact, even just picking it up like that, right? The ink just didn't dry. So, that said, it seems to be working a little bit better on the other side. So what I'm comparing here is the kind of, if I use the back of the glossy paper, or if I use the regular paper, I'm going to cut them both, because I have them both, right? And they're both labeled as zero. So I'm going to use one of them for me, and I'll throw the other one away. Or actually, you know what, I might as well keep them both, because I've got the extra. Yeah, I might as well, right? I mean, why not? What it means is that I'll have, in fact, let me just, this is the back with the glossy the right way, so I'm just going to throw this out right away, too. Meaning I am going to make both of these discs. So I'm just going to, one of them I'll keep and the other one, I don't know what I'll do with it. Maybe I'll drop it off at a radio station or something. Actually, you know what I'll do? I'll give it to, we don't need to talk. One of the people that works at the radio stations goes to some of the drinking holes that I go to, so from time to time. I'd say that it's probably fairly easy to find him if I wanted to. If anybody asked, it was an accident, and it was. I mean, this was not on purpose, but I mean, what? It's a promo disc. It says zero, so there's nothing else I can do with it, really. Yeah, the back of it didn't really. See, I think that if I had let it dry, see, it's different because like on the back, like it didn't. That's not going to dry properly. You can tell by looking at it. Like the writing is really patchy. It might surprise me, but I really don't think so. The front, which is more of a picture, actually looks like a when it's done drying one day, it might look a little bit better. So I'm gonna let that sit kind of for future use, but I'm just gonna go with the medium kind of grade paper here for this. With this particular insert, like this is just I'm not printing on both sides. I'm not stapling anything together. It's just like literally, you know, you cut it open and it pastes kind of thing, right? So like there's really no reason to take it out of the shell. And because there's no reason to, or the sleeve, there's no reason to take it out of the sleeve. And because there's no reason to take it out of the sleeve, what difference does it matter what kind of paper it is, right? I don't know who I'm shipping it to, like at all. People tend to be. I know I'm making good sense. I hope that she accepts my logic. Well, if she watches the vlog, I'm sure she'll see why, and why it makes sense. I just got a promo here for her. This is my first 17 releases, well, minus the one that she bought, because she was interested. So I'm generous. And to be honest with you, I'm less concerned about making $10 and more concerned about, hey, she likes it. Let's get as much of it to her as I can. Maybe she'll show her friends, right? That's of more importance to me at this stage in my music career, rather than, you know, hooray, $10. I mean, I'll take the $10, but I mean, it's not going to change my life, right? So, I'm just going to go with the regular paper with this, meaning, in fact, that's probably already done. I can take that out, and I should have this ready to go soon. And there it is, copy number one, commercial copy number one of record number one. The cover art is actually really... It may seem a little juvenile. This is actually the same cover art that I had in 1998. Almost, like, I scanned it. I scanned the back of it. This is the... I can't even open the... Like, I still have the file from 1998, but I can't open it because the... It's using something called Easy CD Creator, which only works under Windows 98, and it's proprietary, and no, like, it's impossible to find it. But I scanned the back of this, and I used to cut here. But I mean, we can see it's pretty slightly different shade of blue. But like, I made it as close as I could, kind of thing, right? Inside my address from 1998, and. Inri, thanks you for listening. That is all. A little bit of... I want to say worse than... Oliver Wilde. Oscar Wilde, awesome. Jeez. I'm tired. A little bit of Oscar Wilde there for you. But yeah. Kind of... So it looks like it's smudged mildly, but... We can take that. See, this is what I mean though. Like, there's no reason really to take that out ever, right? So that should just sit there like that. So, who cares what kind of paper it is if it just sits there like that, right? And it's the same thing with the back here. Like, are you gonna take that apart and inspect what kind of paper is this? That's kind of silly, don't you think? I mean, like I said, I'm going to wait for that to dry, and future releases may end up being on that type of paper, depending on how it ends up drying, or at least front pages. It's writing. It doesn't seem to like writing, but the actual, like that picture seems a little bit nicer on the other paper, but the writing is illegible, right? So it's like, if I have writing, maybe in the back, that makes sense anyways, right? But just put, like, printer paper in the back, and glossy paper on the front. That may be how I do it in the future. I'm still experimenting with things. We'll see. But this is ready to go, along with the other version. I printed it on a... This is a DVD, and it's a light scribe DVD. And I just printed it on top. It seems to have come out the front here. I may actually just wipe it down. Well, I mean, I don't want to ruin our DVD player, right? We'll see. I'm gonna let it be a little bit, and yeah, I'm out of here. I'm gonna go do things, come back and eat afterwards. Wrong button. So we're going to the post office to mail the thing, the package. It has come down dramatically. The temperature, it's like single digit overnights last couple of nights, and it's only like 12 degrees out right now. I am wearing a sweater, and I will wear a sweater when I go out tonight, so that's how it well, it's halfway through October. It's fall. Some years it snows at this time of year, so I mean, it was just absurdly warm for an absurdly long amount of time. We may still get a couple of nice days. In fact, I'd be surprised if we don't. But a nice day is going to be 17, not, you know, 27. So, the night I went out wasn't the last night I could have, but it was like the second last night I could have. There was a harvest festival going on in Windsor here, which is like, harvest is not late summer anymore. Harvest is the end. Not the beginning of the end, the end of the end. Anyways, I'm getting a coffee. We're going the other way once I get the coffee. Last year, I went to see A Place to Bury Strangers on, I think it was October 6th, I think. It was at the beginning of October. And I wore three sweaters and a jacket. It was cold, it could have snowed. I think it might have actually been. So, I mean, this is ridiculous. This year on the same day, it was like, well, it was October 5th that was out in the tank top at 2 o'clock in the morning.
last year at the same time of night, in fact, I got stuck in Windsor stuck in Detroit that night, and that was really cold, right? Like, scary cold. So, you know, different years, big fluctuations. And I've decided what I'm going to do with that extra copy that I made is I'm going to bring it to the show with me tonight. Yeah, somebody will want it. Or if somebody doesn't want it, maybe I'll leave it there. It is a record store. So, yeah. It's a useful thing to do with a botched copy. Leave it at a record store. Why not? I guess I'm not mailing this out. Apparently it's a holiday today. I don't know what holiday today would be. October 10th. That is not... It's like family day or some holiday that the government made up or something. I don't know. I don't know what day this would be. I'll have to check that when I get home. But I guess I'm not mailing anything out after all. Oh well. It just clicked. You know, day it is today in Canada. It's the Canadian Thanksgiving. That's why it's closed. Okay. I shouldn't be like I'm not surprised that I didn't know that, because like it's not, I don't really even need to get into the whole like Indian Holocaust thing. It's just my family never really celebrated it. I don't really have Christian, like they weren't Christians, they weren't Puritans. It's just it was not something that really happened, or, you know. So it's not surprising to me that it slipped my mind altogether. Anyways, that means the bus service might even be. I should check that. Anyways. Well, I am still planning on going. My head's a little funny. And if it doesn't clear up, then I'm not. So I'm going to get something to eat. I never finished eating. I had had a smoothie, listened to the record, and then sent it off. And that was a big waste of time, which I'm going to wish I spent sleeping. I gotta get something to eat quick and get like an hour worth of sleep or something. And then, you know, and I'm gonna need it, so let's eat. So I just wanna react to this idea. This is 2014, White House press briefing here. But there's something coming up here that kind of made me think of the 2016 election in the United States. One of the reporters is asking, when the president, talks about doing various things, is he not broadcasting his strategy to Russia or to ISIS? And he specifically says to Russia. And the reaction from Pretty Boy Josh here was, he's not, because... they understand that their opponents are going to analyze the situation, and it's a very astute response. I'm not sure how deeply Josh knows of what he says here, and that's like I don't know I don't know the depth of his knowledge, but in fact, when you have these military these military groups, and I mean, you might think on first thought that this doesn't apply to ISIS, but my understanding is that ISIS has demonstrated the exact opposite. ISIS tends to learn very quickly. It seems to be very sophisticated, actually. That's something that I'm learning myself. Its ability to evolve to circumstances on the field is much beyond what you would expect from a group of, you know, religious extremists in the middle of a desert, indicating that they're not what they say, or they're not what we're told, right? It seems like the sophistication of their abilities to evolve suggests that there's some serious military training underlying what they're doing, right? That it's not just a ragtag group of crazies, but that there's some serious training going on with the people that you see on the battlefield there. From where? Well, it's obvious, but there's no need to get into that right now. What's more interesting to me is in the context of the Russians, because this is the Cold War context, right? Again, I don't think we can divorce ISIS from this as strongly, but let's talk about what we know, right? In fact, both the United States and the Russian military, both the American military and the Russian military, have huge operations designed to predict what their opponents do. And the systems that they have are designed to predict any possible outcome, right? So if you were to flip the situation over, I know that one of the companies that, or one of the institutions that does this a lot is the RAND Corporation in the United States. And what they do is they look at the situation and they predict every possible outcome, and they do it all using this sort of game theory analysis, so that everything that their opponents do is predictable. And the Russians have, equivalent systems. They might have taken a bit of a funding hit in the 90s, but the 90s were a long time ago now. And we can expect that there's not really much we could do, or there's not much the Americans could do to flag their intentions that would be beyond the Russians' ability to predict what's occurring. You can be almost certain that whatever the Russians do, we have a contingency plan for. And you can be almost certain that whatever we do, the Russians have a contingency plan for. So this idea that you're like giving away your strategy is just, you hear this from Trump. He says this all the time. And it's just remarkably ignorant as to how these systems actually operate. But more to the point is that it's really scary. Because if you understand a little bit about the dynamics in the Cold War, it was the mutual predictability and assumptions of rationality that kind of prevented us from bombing each other. Over and over and over again. Both of our militaries, and I say our, when we talk about the Russians, I mean NATO, right? Okay, both the NATO military and the Warsaw Pact, I guess, militaries, Soviet militaries, time and time again, had to fall back to the assumption of mutual rationality. We're not going to push the button because our opponents are rational. And if what we're seeing is happening, it must be because it's an error, or maybe we've misunderstood. And had it not been for that predictability and these assumptions of predictability, we probably would not be here right now. None of us. Because the world would have been obliterated under a barrage of bombs. So I know it sounds really, there's a lot of machismo underlying this idea that, if you want to win the war, and you can't be giving off your strategy because then they'll know what you're going to do. It's a mindset that is so ignorant of the reality of the situation that it's hard to understand how you're even hearing it. But the quick answer is the president giving away his strategy? Well, I hope so. Because we don't want them not knowing what we're doing. That would be really dangerous.
Well, it's nearly 7, and I was hoping to catch the 6:30 bus. I was also hoping not to wear any makeup today, but my skin's really bad, so I'm gonna have to wear a little. This is like an indie rock show, so I don't wanna, like, I don't want to show up looking too sexy kind of thing. It's just, I mean, I also want to, like, you know, be presentable. I need to do something with the batteries. I just switched these ones. It shouldn't be going like this. The only thing, other thing I can think of is that maybe I'm not turning them off and they're dying on me because of that. Like, am I leaving the battery? Like, has this been sitting on for a few hours? Because it was a few hours ago they did that over there. Anyways, I'm late. I just need to put some shit on my face and then go. Okay, man. I think I'm looking presentable. Nothing, you know. I don't wanna, you know, show up there looking too hot and, like, creep out a bunch of, you know, skinny little indie kids. So, I think I'm okay. I'm gonna be there. It's gonna be kind of just on time. I need to find the liquor stores here are closed. It's because it's fucking Indian Genocide Day. So. Anyways, I think that there's probably something right over the bridge. If not, I think that I may even be able to get something at the grocery store. Or sorry, at the corner store, like the 7-Eleven kind of thing. I think. I don't know. I don't think it'll be too hard to find, but I am, like I said, I'm running a little late, so let's go. So yeah, I'm gonna say the 8 o'clock bus is probably more likely. I don't. Even if I was to show up at 9:30, 10 o'clock, I think I'll get there to see the band I want to see. It's just, I have never been to this venue before, but I hear it's very small, and people get stuck outside quite frequently. Although people don't play there very often either. I didn't bring my CD. I didn't really have time to cut it up. I did get some sleep this afternoon. That's partly why I'm late. I slept a little bit later than I wanted to. I got 3.5 hours worth of sleep. It's enough, right? Like, so long as I don't drink excessively, and I don't plan to drink excessively tonight, I'll be fine. But, I mean, it's, like, I needed that, right? You might say 3 hours of sleep isn't much, but it's one of those nights where if I didn't get it, I wouldn't be going anywhere. So, but it does mean I'm a little late, and it doesn't mean I didn't finish, cutting up that disc, so, At least the tunnel's running on a normal schedule today, so there's no holiday schedule. I'm not gonna get stuck on that, so that's good. Caddywhompus is if you like the genre of music, you should probably know who they are. I'm gonna describe them as the kind of sound. Like a mix between the Animal Collective and Sonic Youth. At their core, what they're doing is kind of similar to what the Animal Collective were doing mid-2000s, which was really the only period that I think they were interesting. I don't like their early stuff or their later stuff. There was really just that one record in 2005 that I thought was interesting. But what Caddywhompus is doing is they're kind of fixing what I would criticize the Animal Collective for, in a way. I've noticed this before, I'm often interested or at least knowledgeable about the kind of movement acts I found in the mid-2000s that they weren't any good, and it was the kind of the acts on the margins that I found more interesting, because they were fixing kind of the problems that all the movement acts had. So one of the problems, or one of the things that I found boring about the Animal Collective is that they didn't have any grit, right? It was just, like, aimless, pretentious trash. Caddywhompus kind of fixed that by infusing with it with a little bit more punk rock energy, right? It's the same basic idea, but there's more riffs. It moves. It's more fun. So that's what this is. Kind of a... They're a small band. They don't have a big audience, but they're known in circles. I gotta get a ticket here. Back in a minute. So yeah, I mean, if you're at all interested in, I wanna avoid the term indie rock. Just because it's kind of loaded. But if you're at all interested in alternative rock music, and I mean that in its literal sense, because that's what it really is. It's kind of like rock music, but kind of not at all at the same time. This is one of the more interesting
acts operating in that spectrum. And they're acknowledged that way. This is not they're not obscure in the proper circles, even if you've never heard of them. So yeah, it's caddywhompus. I expect it to be a good show. I hope I get in. I'm a little later than I want it to be. You know, I wore a sweater and I overheated, so I took it off, but the overnight is about 10 degrees tonight. It doesn't feel like it right now. Like I think it's at 12 when I left. I'm comfortable in a t-shirt right now, so, you know, I have a sweater. But it's going to be chilly tonight. We'll see if all this exercise walking keeps me warm or not. Anyways, something else I forgot to do was get the tickets printed off for Touche Amore. I guess I'll have to print them and pick them up the day of. Yeah, well, we'll check to see if this is still, when I get home tonight, I'll check to see if it's still tactical or not. I didn't even check my budget, so I am planning on it. It's in Lansing. Like I said, I've never been to Lansing. We'll see about that. I saw the bus turn around, so it should be just about here. I shouldn't have to wait long. So I've suspected before there's something funny with this driver. I saw the bus come out around the little loop-de-loop over there. Unless that driver was off, which is... You know, the buses are coming every half an hour right until midnight. Doesn't make any sense. So... Oh no, wait, it's every hour after. Okay, so... But even so, it's not until 9:30, right? Like I said, I saw the bus come around. That was like 20 minutes ago. Like, where did the bus driver go? What the bus should have done was go around and sit here for 20 minutes until it was time to go, kind of thing. So, like, what the fuck, right? Even if that was the late bus, like even if that was a 7:30 bus that was late, it still should have come right through here. So, I am convinced that these drivers are not working the way they're supposed to. Anyways, I don't know when the bus will be here, but I still hope I get in. That's all I can say. It's 10 after now. This has never happened before, you know? I've been stuck on the other side and not able to get back, like, fairly often. I've never been stuck here and not able to get over. That's never... I don't know, maybe they're being extra fascistic today. But like I said, I saw the bus come around. Where did the bus go? It should be here. Well, at least it was quick once it got through. It'll be about 25 after once I get over. I'm going to be there pretty much the last minute I could expect to be and still get in. We'll find out what happens. So good to know that there was a liquor store literally across the street from the tunnel. The tunnel's right there. Liquor store's right there. I'm walking that way. I'm going to guess it's about a half an hour. Well, I know it's about a half an hour. I guess I haven't been here before, but I walked by there. On the way to Chelsea. It's on the way to L Club. But it's about halfway, and if it's an hour to L Club, it's a half an hour there. So that's the goal. It means that I need to be out of there around 12:30. I'm drinking Mike's tonight, which is, we can deal with that. Big drinks, that's fine. Absolutely fine. Okay, so, yeah, let's start walking. This little strip over the highway is not bad, really. It's, like, it feels... It's like an industrial area, right? And so you feel kind of like... Industrial areas at night feel abandoned. That's what it feels like, right? And it's Detroit, so it's just that much more. And, you know, there's lots of green spaces and trees and stuff. It's actually a pleasant walk. It's more like Windsor, but... There's always someone with a dog. I swear that dog was gonna jump me. Around the corner, I'm walking down a nice, it's like a nice kind of open boulevard. and I look over on the side, and there's like, I don't know, it's like a husky or something, and it's about to pounce, man. It's it's amazing how much, you know, like a large dog can really, you know, interrupt a nice pleasant walk. I was having a nice walk.
Really?
It is chilly out, but it feels nice when you're walking, right? And then someone's fucking dog had to ruin that. Anyways, I'm on Trumbull. Bagley's the next one up, and it's, I don't know, it's like a block. It's right before the, when I walked through here last time, I was concerned about the coyotes over the railroad tracks. The venue was right before the railroad tracks, so hopefully the noise keeps the coyotes away.
I used other toilet paper. Sorry.
Caddywhompus just finished, and I heard the next band state ominously that they need to follow that, and they were very jaded by the responsibility to follow that. It was a good set, maybe a bit. Well, we'll talk about it later. But the Caddywhompus set is done. It was good. I like kind of classy in the backdrop here. You got the chandelier, and I'm in like an auto garage in the back end of Detroit. It's a reminder of the previous wealth. I heard that band mention that now they gotta follow that band, and it's, oh no, now they have to follow Caddywhompus. What do you do? They actually gave it a good go. It was an enjoyable set. I don't even know what they were called. They weren't at the top of the bill. Like, there was some Donovan something, and they played, like, there was a second band that played, and then Caddywhompus played second, and the headliner was, like, at the bottom of the bill, and I don't even know which one it was, kind of thing. Like, I paid no attention to it, because I came to see Caddywhompus, right? But they were actually pretty good, so I don't even know what they were called. I'll figure it out when I get home. But they were, the drummer really drove them fairly well. So that was enjoyable. Anyways, I've got lots of time, but I didn't need to mosey towards the tunnel, so I'm out. So I still don't know what exactly this is. Is this gas powered? Like, it's obviously lighting the light, and they're all over the place, but like, United Rentals, what are they? It does not say. It looks like a generator, but what is it? It has an exhaust. If it has an exhaust, that suggests it's some kind of fossil fuel. I don't. They're everywhere around here. I don't. Like, it's crazy. Now they are performing a useful service in lighting. Like, is there not a grid? There is a grid, isn't there? Like, I'm confused. I really am. But I know someone's getting paid, right? I have to say that I'm happy that I'm finally getting like a directional concept of Detroit. I don't really need to rely on street signs anymore. Like, I know where I am, kind of thing. Growing up in Ottawa, it was so weird moving to like Detroit, Windsor. Like, I mean, I've got a good concept of Windsor now, but I spent far more time there, right? It's finally getting a good idea of like where I am in Detroit, rather than, okay, this is the street sign, this is where I memorize the streets go. It's a very, like, it's an emancipating feeling to know, okay, I know where that hotel is. I'm gonna walk through a parking lot because I know where the hotel is, right? And I know where to go once I get there. Very emancipating. I almost stopped at the McDonald's, but we're gonna go for nachos instead. That's the way I roll, right? This was a good show. It was a good night. I spent a while waiting at the bus station, but the banter was actually enjoyable, so I don't really have much to complain about with that. Sometimes I bitch about the bus station, but it was okay tonight. Yeah. Enjoyable banter. So, I guess I have some bureaucracy to do once I get home still. I don't want to say that this is like the end of bureaucracy for a while, because I think that show's coming up. But I need to do a little bit of bureaucracy before I can confirm the show. That's probably the extent of the evening, if that. I've been clear that I want to transit. Well, I need to close the disc. That might actually. I almost closed it walking up Bagley. A thought crossed my mind. Should I close the disc right now? I decided not to. In fact, the I went through a kind of a classic focus losing process there. And I'm just remembering it now, kind of thing. But the thought process did cross my mind, and then it went away through whatever kind of mental rambling I went through. I don't even think we need to talk about it. But anyways, we'll see what comes up when it comes up. There's no use in rambling right now. So that was definitely a good night. We got two good bands, an alright band. We got some nice walking in, and we even got some nice tunnel waiting banter. So tonight was a good night. I'm happy with tonight. I am tipsy, but only halfway to Turby. So I don't know if I'll be awake or not for much longer, but we'll see. I have plans to not pass out. We'll see what happens. So the next video on my list is President Obama visits Stonehenge. Whoa. It's loading. Come on. I want to see President Obama visit Stonehenge. Come on. Come on. Okay, but where does this spliff?
This is the tallest one.
So it'd be these three. These are some special stones. Right?
Yeah.
So
these are
original.
Yes,
there's
a
flower inside that.
This one is
just. That's a good point. A lot of it isn't.
Yes, well, they're lichens, and in fact, they're really interesting in their own right, because there's some here that are maritime species, and it shouldn't really be here.
Is that right?
Yes.
There's something here. It's wonderful. It's very cool. There's just something elemental about it. There's something that, where you kind of feel like
there's something here.
It always be there.
Yeah.
Right? Well, then it comes out of something basic. Yeah. Doesn't it? Yeah. It's
spectacular.
Yeah, I could come here like every day.
On my own. In the morning.
You know, if I would come here. Just kind of, if it wasn't like a monument, I'd sit on one of his rocks, and I just...
Yeah, we know what you do.
It would really...
I would too.
I'm just
going to
stand here for a second.
Yeah,
we give you a
minute.
Give me a minute. I want to do it.
Yeah,
it's
whoa.
So it's 8 o'clock in the morning. I've been up for an hour already. I'm going to go do the things today that I didn't do yesterday. Post office, get some salami, these things. I only got like 2 hours worth of sleep, so I think that we're going to just carry the day on. That way I can do the bureaucracy that I promised I was going to do yesterday but didn't do. You know, we can close 14 and 15, and etc. So, let's carry the day on. I should probably be more tired. I had some coffee that helped. I'll no doubt pick up some hangover juice on the way to the store, and etc. So, yeah.
Brisk morning. I have a sweater in my bag. I don't know, like, I went out with a sweater yesterday and it was initially comfortable, but then I got warm, so I took it off. And it was the same thing when I went to the show in a sweater, but I got cool, so I took it off. I put it back on before I left, which was, I'm sure, I'm happy I brought it, but, and now I'm going out today initially without one. I do suspect that I'll probably put one on when I get to the store up here. It's just that time of year where you're never, it's not clear. It's about 8:30 now, so I'm going to guess it's around 10, 11 degrees up. By the time I come back, I'll probably want to take it off, so it's going to be, yeah, ambiguous. The point of ambiguity where you don't know if you should put a sweater on or not, and nobody's going to tell you. You just need to figure that shit out on your own, you know. But it doesn't feel right either way. You know? You just need to figure out that shit out on your own. That's all. The post office was trying to tell me how to declare something and send it as a small packet, which is bullshit. I've sent out dozens, if not hundreds, of CDs and bubble packages, and nobody's ever told me I had to declare it as a small package before. But she wouldn't budge, and she was essentially just trying to rip me off. So I'm going to go to a different post office, the one down the street here. I either I've been doing this wrong for 20 years, or it's bullshit, right? So I'm pretty sure this is bullshit. Ugh. It's like 9-ish. I guess I'm gonna get some salami and then go home and then come back. I don't really have any other... This will get shipped today. I promise you, fan in Missouri, that you will get your item shipped today. It's just... I should have checked the hours. I checked the hours on the one downtown, and it was 8, and they were open. And I just assumed this would be open at 8, too. Bad assumption. Yeah. Be back in a few hours, I guess. I mean, what else am I gonna do?
And it's 20 after 10 already. So, I guess I'm gonna be heading back out in a few minutes. You know. What can I say? This is not, you know, I was hoping to get this all the way around. I should do the cleaning today, right? Laundry, cleaning in here, all those things that I've been putting off. Like, I was doing something and it was gonna be, I'll do it later kind of thing. I should finally do it. Like, I'm way past due on it, right? So I should finally do it. Yeah. Yeah, that needs to be the rest of the day. We'll come back and we'll do some talking, no doubt, but that's the rest of the day for sure.
I am willing to finally concede that the numbers are moving a little. Now, I'm not sure Trump is moving much. I think Trump is probably just about flatlined. Regardless of the media narrative, to me, the story of this election has been how stable the numbers are, how flat they are. Somebody who's been talking like that for the whole way through is Monmouth, which is the university that's doing polling. I think Quinnipiac is a university as well.
But I mean, regardless, like Monmouth is the academic source, and call me a nerd, I'll agree with you, but I'm gonna go more for the academic source and be very, very skeptical of any kind of, free market type source. I'm very skeptical of anything that involves markets, including polling. You know, markets make things worse, always, and that's gonna be the same thing with the polling as well. I'm gonna trust the public sector polling before I trust the private sector polling. Always. And they've been saying the same thing, right? They've been saying that very little movement in the data, straight line, they're not really assigning much of anything. And they're arguing that, you know, this idea that, you know, these little things that are, do these little things make a difference? They don't, right? The media wants a story, so they manipulate the polls, they make shit up. You know, candidate X said something mean about this group, and the polls went way up, and then they fell down, and, like, this is a fantasy reality. That doesn't happen. It never happens. Not in any country, not in any election. Polling is generally, broadly, pretty stable, but when things do switch, they switch hard, and they switch fast, right? And this has kind of been my argument the whole time through, is that you can't do things like look at regression analyses. You can't really, like, one event is not going to swing an election, usually, unless it's something like a terrorist attack, right? But the instability is nonetheless real. It's just that it's unpredictable, right? So you've got to look at it, and, you know, once in a while, if you're lucky, you'll be able to pull out a trend, right? Even the last election in Canada, there wasn't really a trend. Well, okay, something kind of pulled itself out at the last couple of weeks, and what it was the left consolidating behind the Liberals, and it happened in two jumps, right? What happened at first was there was an initial movement, and that put the Liberals up. So for the first third of the election, the NDP was way up. And then for the second third of the election, pretty much all three parties were tied. And what people did was they looked at the situation, and they concluded it. And this was psychological, right? Is they concluded that the Liberals had a better chance of winning than the NDP. Was that mathematically true? No. Not at that point in time. But because the Liberals are the natural governing party and the NDP are the perpetual protest third party, people got it through their minds that if they're tied, then the Liberals have a better chance of winning. So, and then in the last third of the election, it was a huge movement from the NDP to the Liberals. But it wasn't like there wasn't like a trend line, and it was like a step function, right? It was like, right? Like, and that's how elections usually are more often. Like, that's what usually happens in elections, right? I think that we may actually be lucky enough, and I'm not gonna do these analyses, I'll let someone else do them, but I think that we may actually be lucky enough that if we look carefully, we are actually going to see a trend in this data. And you can do it with all your, you know, your nice regression algorithms. You got the best algorithms. You can go ahead and throw them down. And I think that you will see a trend line come up with women, and specifically undecided women. And it's going to be the difference between, you know, a comfortable to sketchy Clinton win, right? Where she gets like 280-ish to a Clinton blowout, where she's got like 350, 400. And I do think it's happening. But I mean, it's not going to be because of the tape that was released. It's not going to be because of the thing that he said about the beauty pageant lady. It's not going to be because of any of these things. It's going to be the culmination of them. Right? And you're going to see that trend line. And it's not, you're not going to see Trump's numbers shift, right? And this is another point that I'm trying to get across, is if you look at the numbers for Trump, the media is reporting them like, you know, Clinton 45, Trump 42 or something, right? In actuality, what the numbers are actually saying is something more along the lines of Clinton 43, Trump 35, undecided 15. And the assumption is that the undecideds distribute. What I'm suggesting is that what I'm seeing here just kind of, you know, like I say, this is weak, right? But I think that if you look at, you are starting to see the gender gap open up with women, and you're starting to see the undecideds come down a little bit. The assumption is that Trump is polling at 35, and as the undecideds come down, his numbers will come up. I'm not sure that's a good assumption. What I think you may end up seeing in the end is that Trump is polling at 35 and his numbers will not come up as the undecideds come down. Or if those numbers come up, it'll be just a little bit, right? He'll come up from 35 to 38. But Clinton's numbers will come up a lot, from 45 to 55. Reason being that the undecideds are not distributing, but are moving disproportionately to Clinton. And specifically, it's the undecided women. But the undecideds in general. The reason being is that... we've been seeing massive stability, right? But the massive stability is partisan. Part of that massive stability is that we've got 10-15% undecided. That's a part of the stability in the election. Is that there's a sizable chunk of people that just don't want to pick one. While all of this nonsense might not affect anybody in anybody's base, it is probably going to affect the undecided people who are going to look at the situation and say, holy shit, this guy's... we can't, you know? One of the... it might not surprise Trump supporters, and it might not surprise Democrats, but if you have not decided yet, then you're not paying attention. You know, maybe you hate them both, right? I know that myself, I would have been, well, I'm not undecided. I have decided that I don't like either of them. But there was a long period up until the middle of the summer where, I mean, I wasn't really... I wasn't convinced that Clinton was a lesser evil, and I'm still not convinced that Clinton is a lesser evil. But I've developed a thought process, right? And a part of that process is watching Trump, right? You can't believe what Trump says. His intelligence level is not very impressive, and these et cetera kinds of things. Even if there's a couple of policies I like better, and there's a lot of things about Clinton that I hate, I can say that I have gone from undecided to Clinton, right? And this bullshit is part of it. Not because I'm making a moral value judgment or anything, but it's just a broader, you know, a broader feeling that this guy's a dipshit, and you can't do that, right? This can't happen, right? It just when I talk about red lines, it's like it's just falling through a rabbit hole, right? It's just like this is gone too far, right? In a lot of ways, the kind of candidate that Trump is maybe the kind of thing that might swing somebody like me. But he made a lot of bad choices. The whole abortion thing, the whole willingness to work with social conservatives thing, it's, you know, it's just not going to swing me. I pointed this out repeatedly. Had he swung libertarian, and I think that, frankly, I think he is probably more of a libertarian than he is a social conservative. I don't think that Trump is a social conservative at all. And it's boggling my mind to watch these people that think that he is. I think he's a liberal Republican, right? That's what he is. He's a libertarian on a lot of things, but he had to pander to voters, and just watching them, I cannot believe how stupid they are. But for every idiot that he got to, you know, buy into this, he lost two people that might have been considering their options when presented with a candidate as poor as Hillary Clinton, right? You know, and you get the trade thing. It's like, I don't like the, you know, investors' rights agreements that we pretend are free trade agreements, but I don't think that the solution is to increase tariffs and build walls. I think that the solution is to have more open borders and environmental standards and labor standards. The solution is not less integration, but more integration. And etc. Right? I'm rambling. So yeah, I don't think that Trump's numbers are really going. What's happening is not that people that were going to vote for Trump. I was talking about how I was undecided, and I changed. You know. I know that a lot of the people that say that they're undecided in a poll like that are just not going to vote at all. I understand that. They're not necessarily undecided so much as a lot of them are just disinterested. But even if you distribute half of it, if Trump's numbers aren't moving, then he's, you know? If he's at 35 and none of them vote, he's still at 35, right? So, what I'm getting across is I'm not trying to argue that the numbers are moving because Trump supporters have seen the light and changed their mind and voting for Clinton. What I'm pointing out is that there's a big number of people that claim they haven't decided yet. And from what I've been able to see is that there seems to be a movement of those people towards towards Clinton. and that's going to skew the numbers. Or to phrase that properly, what that's going to mean is that the numbers that you're seeing are skewed. And it means that they're skewed in favor of Trump. So the long-term trend being that he's going to stay flat as the undecideds decide, he will stay flat and she will increase. And so that 35-36 that he's running at is not going to go up much, you know, a point or two. You know, 35 will go up to 38. But her 43 is going to go up to like 50-something. That's what I'm seeing out of the data. Now, I would like to see something specific. Again, if we go back to the Canadian election, I had very specific data. They asked undecided voters who they would be most likely to vote for, and the Conservatives were just dead. Undecided meant I haven't decided between the Liberals or the NDP. That's what undecided means. What I'm getting the impression of in the American election, and I wish I had more specific data, but what I'm getting the impression of is that undecided, broadly speaking, means I haven't decided if I'm going to vote for Clinton or I'm not going to vote at all. That's what I'm getting at here. And what it means is that instead of having this, you know, she's up by 6-7 points, you know, 49-42, it might end up looking something more like 54-38. Because she gets that big bump. And see, that makes it look like I'm taking numbers from Trump and giving them to Clinton, but that's not what I'm doing. What I'm doing is I'm saying that the undecideds are not going to distribute evenly, so less undecideds will go to Trump, so that 35 will not become 42, but will only become 38. And the rest will go to Clinton. Which may even just be because less people vote. Like I say, I'd love to see somebody do a poll and ask that question. specifically only pull the undecideds. And try to figure out what they're thinking. Ask them who they would be more likely to vote for. And I'm pretty... It's a weak signal, and it's just from looking at tables, right? And saying, okay, wait a second, this is moving in that direction. I'm not using the algorithms. You want to do the algorithm, go ahead, like I say. See, here's the thing, is these algorithms are really nice after the fact, right? You can look after the election and say, oh, gee, there was a movement here. It doesn't really help you in the meantime. You've kind of got to guess. And my guess is that you are going to see that there is a trend. And that trend is that undecided women are moving disproportionately, a very large disproportion towards Clinton. And it means that overall undecideds are moving very strongly to Clinton. And if that's true, then the numbers that you're seeing are understating support for Clinton and exaggerating support for Trump. Which is the exact opposite of what you're thinking, right? It's weak, it could pass. I have a feeling it won't, but it is just a feeling.
One more time. They better let me ship it at normal price, otherwise I'm going to have to... If it costs $10 to ship it, then I'm going to have to change shipping to $10. I don't think... Like I say, what I should be able to do is put it in one of those little jewel packages. Right, those little bubble wrap things, and so long as it goes for the slot, I should be able to put it in the regular mail. I don't know why. In fact, if I remember correctly, I've had that problem at that post office before. Right, so we'll try there. I may, if things go awry here, I may try the furthest one because it's nice out. Looking at 17, 18, it's still going to be a little chilly, but. It's going to be, by the time I get out there, I think it'll be nice. So, let's hope this gets out. This will be mailed today, I promise that. Promise.
No air conditioner. Okay, this is good to know. I did, I took it down to 23. It was a little cold, so I took it back up a little bit, but, it's, you know. 23, 24, 25-ish, that's more reasonable than the 28, 29. I had to have that because of the fucking air. Anyways. This is, temperature came up. It's actually quite nice. I'm gonna guess it's probably around 15. A couple of degrees difference, you know. The difference between 10 to 12 and 14 to 16 is like, it's the biggest 2 or 3 degrees you can get, right? It's mailed. This shipping was $5, but then with the parcel it was $7, so I guess that's, you know, I'll have to change that. It cost me more to send that to Missouri
than it cost me to send something to the UK a few months ago. Same basic package, if you can believe that. It's cheaper to send things by mail to the UK than it is to send it to the Midwest in the United States. If I could explain why, I don't know. I thought we had a free trade agreement. Anyways, I don't know if that would. Well, you want to explain to me why it's cheaper to send something to the UK than to send it to the US if it's not a tariff? I don't. Anyways, it's sent, and I'll have to make that adjustment. She gave me like she didn't give me the. It's just like I don't want to lose money on this, right? It's not. I'm not making a big profit or anything. It's just I want to make sure that whatever the price I'm putting it at is so that I am making something, right? I'm not getting anywhere if I'm losing money shipping items, right? And it was, she gave me $5 for shipping, I spent $7. So I lost $2 there. But the flip side of that is that the list price was $10 and she gave me $20. So, I mean, it works out. And I mean, I thought, it doesn't cost me $10 to make the disc, right? That's more like $2 to make the disc, right? So, I mean, it's, $10 for a CD, I think most people would agree that's fairly cheap, to be honest with you. So, if I change it so that it's $10 for the CD plus, if I put shipping to 10, then that's $20 in total, and that's what, you know. The reason I do that, I was thinking about that, you know. I can imagine people are going to be kind of like, you know, the list price is 10, but then when you go, you know, it's like 10 plus hidden shipping charges. Well, here's the thing. If I put $20 as a list price, excuse me, instead of 10, then the site will take $10 out, right? Like they'll, sorry, I didn't articulate that well, is they'll take their percentage on the full price. If I put the list price as $10 and shipping as you know, then they don't, there's a sneaky way to do that, right? I could put the CD, I could put it up $1 and then put $20 for shipping, and then I'm not paying the site anything because they won't nail you on shipping, right? But I mean, people will, if I explain that, maybe they'll get it. I don't know. At the same time, I don't want to. I actually like the model that they're using, you know, and I mean, I don't have the resources to put up my own site and do that, right? So, I kind of don't want to, I don't want to do that, right? I actually would like to support the model. I think that that's the right model. I don't like these streaming sites or whatever else. The right way to move forward is to do this kind of independent sales kind of thing, right? And I mean, a label would take more than they're taking, so, you know. But I mean, it's a part of the thing, right? It's to take, well, whatever they put down is, so she put 20 down and they have 10%, so they took $2 on that, right? So, well, when you work it out, she gave me 25, I spent 7 on shipping, so it's 18, and then Bandcamp took 2, 16, and then PayPal took about 15, right? That's 15, and it cost me a couple of dollars, so I made about $10, right? Which is not like, it's just I need to ensure that I am making a couple of dollars on each purchase, right? Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense. Whether it's, you know, I think, you know, around $10 would, you know, it kind of makes sense. I am going to change the shipping option, though. It's just, you know, I can't, I'm sorry, you know, take it up with the post office. Like, it doesn't make sense for me to put a shipping price that's less than shipping is. So I will have to change that. Anyways, it's out. Like I say, it balances out in the specific. The last time I did it to the UK, it was the same thing, right? I think I had 7 and I changed to 10. Right now it's 5. I'm gonna change to 10. It costs, that doesn't make sense to me, but it apparently costs more to send it to the US than it does to send it to international. If you can explain that to me, I'll type it up there. Give me a primer so I understand it. Because, that's gone over my head, whatever the reasons for it are. I am not on campus. I'm not in school anymore. I'm too old for that now. No, really. You know, like, even a couple of years ago, like, I was in school a couple of years ago. A couple of years ago, actually, that's more like... Okay, so it's not a couple of years ago anymore. It's like 4 or 5 years now. But, you know, like... If I was still going to school, my prerogative would be... It wouldn't be trying to get more cops on campus. It would be trying to get less cops on campus. Because I would feel as though I was being locked down in a police state. It's kind of strange to me how we've gotten to this, you know. I don't think we need to get into this kind of, you know, these kind of talking points that you hear all the time. I don't really want to take either side, to be honest with you. But, I mean, I'm fairly open about my politics. I'm an anarchist. And, you know, like, this whole cops everywhere thing, I would be protesting against that. And I would be seeing it as, you know, an issue where the administration is trying to clamp down on... I mean, if you take it outside of the context of a campus and you see, like, like, who wants cop cars on every corner all the time? You know? It's... And I can't really get my head around, you know, this idea that young people are in favor of more heavy-handed policing. Like, what rabbit hole did we fall down, you know? So, yeah, I mean, I wouldn't produce the rant you might be expecting me to produce there, because I'm not on that side of the political spectrum. I'm a left-wing anarchist. I think we should fight oppression everywhere we see it, but that means that we don't want cop cars everywhere. Not that we do, you know? So just to keep going on that little, like, my analysis is that the police are there to protect property, right? The police uphold the system. That's their job, is to ensure that, you know, this whole white heteropatriarchal thing, that's what the cops' job is to do, is to uphold that. So how do we get to the point where kids think that the cops are there to, like, protect minorities or something? Like, this is... It's Orwellian. It is. You know, and that's the rabbit hole that we've gone through, right? The cops are there to protect you. That's what they actually think. Cops are not there to put black people in jail. The cops are there to prevent you from saying mean things to black people. Like, how did we lose the correct analysis here and get lost in this kind of hyper-authoritarian thinking? Like I say, I'm starkly anti-oppression. I'm an anarchist. That's what we're all about, is about tearing down, you know, these systems that exist to keep us all in chains, mental chains, right? I don't see how... I don't even want to say that. I do see how putting police everywhere is working against the goals you would expect liberals to be, and liberals broadly speaking, right? Left-wing anarchists are somewhere near liberals. When you're real liberals, you know, on the political spectrum. If you want to be binary, we're not conservatives, that's for sure, right? So, but it's
You know, the word I'm looking for is a reactionary. That's the word I'm looking for. It's highly reactionary. Like I said, I don't go to school anymore. That's not my battle to fight. But if I was there, I would be more likely to organize a protest against the police presence on campus than I would to be fighting for more campus security. While, you know, pushing for the kinds of, you know, shifts in the social revolution, right? Push for that, but cops don't bring us to the social revolution. They glue the system that exists in place. They uphold the status quo. Like, do you think the static? I don't. Like I said, I'm trying to get across that I'm coming at this from a very different perspective, right? And I don't like the temporary allies I may end up, but I certainly wouldn't want to be on the side of the people that want to. I might be on the side of on most other issues, right? And that is a breaking point for me. Cops everywhere, that's a big breaking point for me. So yeah, that's really just my point there, is like, it's not my battle, I don't want to get into it, it's like, I'm past that stage of my life, but I would be far more likely to be involved in protests against heavy-handed policing than I would be to argue for more cops. That's not, I don't want more cops. No, thank you. So there might be something heavy going on down there at the 7-Eleven. It's the 7-Eleven I go to all the time. I don't know. I'm gonna avoid that, but it looks like something nasty down there. Okay, so the rest of the day is gonna be a process of remembering little things I need to do before I can shift over. So, first things first, let's eat. Okay, that was just a small meal. It was the rest of the nachos from yesterday. About a half a plate there. A little less than half, let's say 40%. 40% of the plate. Meaning I had 60% of the plate yesterday. So that was task one. Task two is the kitchen. It's amazing how fast the kitchen goes, isn't it? Like, it was just, like, yesterday at this time, it was actually, you know, reasonable. Okay, so, let's get the dishes and let's get that kind of dealt with, too. And it is now time for another garbage bag update. As we can see, this still has a good ways to go. It compressed as we thought. Let's get a nice pile of stuff in, and in fact we're gonna I'm not gonna cut this up this time, so let's just put it all in together. Okay, first things up, this is what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 bags of Doritos. Now, you'll remember, well, maybe you won't, probably don't, but if you go back and look on the vlogs, the bag's actually, I have to fold it in a little bit. I think that's gonna make any difference in the long run, right? I pointed out that I was gonna stop eating Doritos. And I actually was pretty good for a while. And then I started going out drinking again, and I missed lots of Doritos. If I don't... The big bags are from the debate, and I did enjoy that. If I don't drink, then I won't, I won't get stuck with the nachos. Anyways, that was... Was that 8 or 10? Whatever it was a lot. Next up is 1, 2, 3... 4, 5, 6. 6 cheese wrappers. Going right in there. We also have, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 100, 101, 102, 103, 104, 105, 106, 107, 108, 109, 110, 111, 112, 113, 114, 115, 116, 117, 118, 119, 120, 121, 122, 123, 124, 125, 126, 127, 128 3. Sorry, stuff stuck to this, but that is 4 produce bags. Produce bags meaning tomatoes, green peppers. Yeah, tomatoes, green peppers. That's what would end up in those bags. Okay, we've got the mustard from, I guess at the end of September when I needed something to put on my spaghetti. This is, this was at the bottom of one of the strawberry containers, I don't know, whatever. This is a little bit of the scrunchy thing. Put that in there. Some masking tape from carrying batteries around in my pocket. That was the Mars bar from the day that I stopped on the park bench. That should be over in the other room. We have one. Yeah, that's it. One fettuccine. My diet. I have not been eating as much this month as I would normally. This is actually from printer paper from yesterday. It's the inside of a Kleenex box. This is lots of stickers. I think that's some more of the paper from the printer paper. And this is toilet paper container. Ooh, one more thing. I actually forgot about that. This is 1, 2, 3 salami wrappers. So, judging by that, it must have been mid to early September that we did the last one. We can go back and check. But, yeah. Let's, well, I'll be back in a sec. I've got to put the books back and we'll talk. But, I mean, as you can see, the bag looks a lot fuller. Oh, actually, I forgot one other thing. Forgot because, yeah. These pens, I bought a pack of pens just at the store a little while back. And every single one of them did that. Yeah. They were just like Bic pens, you know, it's not like... But every single one of them in the pack did that. Bad pens. Very bad pens. I think there was 3 in the pack, so... But, I mean, either way, they were bad pens for sure. And now I'm going to have to go buy some more pens soon. When did I buy those? I think I bought those for Tortoise, so that was in March. Yeah. Like, I didn't even use most of them. This one, like, I had just started using it. I had used it for, like, maybe a day. And they all did, every single one. It's, as soon as I put it in my bag, it's like they can't transit. Useless. So yeah, let me put the books back in and then we can talk in a sec. There's just 2 there. Okay, so I think that the right way to understand the bag here is that I've gone through a new phase. One where the books are no longer tight, meaning that just the base, like what it is that, what I mean is that the bag is kind of coming out of shape, I guess is what I'm trying to say, right? So that there's more, space in the, well, I don't want to say there's more space in the bag, because there's not more space in the bag, it's just that, I pushed it down, right, so it's compressing outwards. And now the area underneath the bag, sorry, the area underneath the books is wider than it was. So what I should really do is get more books. But I'm not going to do that yet because it will eventually kind of just do it itself kind of thing. So this is... And don't try to make too much sense of what I'm trying to say. I realize I'm articulating myself poorly. I hope that what I'm trying to get across is clear. And that's that by pushing the pressure down, the bag has been kind of puffed out,
to its maximum extent here, right? Which means that there's more space at the top just by opening that up here, right? The reason the books are like that is because that was the maximum amount of... Okay. So it's actually kind of both, right? I've got more space here, and I've got more space here. And the reason that's happening, like I say, is because the base is expanding out because of the pressure downwards. What that means is that, like I say, what I could do is I could put another book in here, right? But I think that that's kind of unnecessary, and that it will shape in itself down kind of thing. Yeah. If we get to a point where there's just like a little bit of extra space here, then, you know. But I'm kind of in the broader scheme of things. You'll note that the books are still not coming out of the bag, right? I still have enough loose space here that the books are still resting underneath the top of the bag here, right? We'll know that, well, what that means is that we haven't even started getting full yet, right? Like, this is not even the beginning of full. The beginning of full, and again, like, I should probably have something here, because it's opening that space there, right? Like I say, in time, that will resolve itself, kind of thing. Even if it ends up a little bit, well, actually, yeah, no, I should push that over as much as I can, and, yeah, wow. So once I do that, look how much space I have over here now, right? So, the bag is getting bent out of shape, but it's not even close to being full yet, and there's still lots to go. I'm at, 9 months? Yeah. So, I'm clearly kind of tired, but I don't plan on going to sleep. It's about 2 o'clock. Okay. I think we're done rambling enough about that. We see what I put in. We see how much space there is left. We see how much longer it's going to be. I initially said a year would be a long time. I'd say we're on track to filling it halfway by the first year. This could be 2 years, I guess, very easily. Okay, so get back to we're doing loose ends in here. I'm not going to clean in here yet. I'm going to come back and do that after. I'm not going to do anything in here for now. It's kind of more like I will come back to cleaning in here, but the loose ends, there's no loose ends to do in here. Rather, I've got loose ends to do in here, but the first thing I'm going to do before I go in here is I'm going to brush my teeth. On second thought, the next loose end thing I need to do is call the ear doctor and see if I get an appointment done. Just so, like I said, I looked into this a little bit, it's describing all of my symptoms. So, I don't know what she's going to say about it. It's a little, the thing is that it does seem to be a little bit obscure. It's not, entirely accepted that, these things, can cause that, but at the very least, how can I put this? The vascular loop does not always create the symptoms that I'm describing, but there is certainly a lot of evidence that suggests that the symptoms I'm describing are often correlated with the vascular loop. And so maybe there's a
Like maybe it's a symptom of a deeper kind of concern. I don't know. What causes a vascular loop? I don't know. Right. So, I suppose these are the sorts of things that I should get a doctor to explain to me. And it would be nice if she had not discharged me after she sent me to get the MRI. No doubt, again, assuming that there was nothing actually wrong. What the hell is that? Instead of a hot tub or something? Weird. I should, Wow, am I ever scattered. Okay. I'm just tired. I'm not having an episode or anything. It's just what happens when you don't sleep, and this is going to be a 3-day vlog. So yeah, that's what happens. So I see if I can get an appointment. It'd be nice if I can get the appointment on the same day as the appointment for the GP. Part of the reason why I was wanting to avoid her is because I don't want to do the, like, I don't want to walk in there and gloat and be like, yeah, I knew there was something wrong with my ear. You're a bad doctor, you know, like, I don't want to go through that process, but I mean, I think that I kind of have to do something. I'm not going to get to see the other doctor until December. I don't expect the GP to really understand what it says, right? So, even if I don't think she's a very good doctor, and even if I end up going to see a different doctor, I still, like, I have to take a chance here, right? Because I might be wrong. I might walk in there, and she might look at it, and, you know, she might literally be like, holy shit, I missed this. This is because of this, this is the consequence of this, you want to go see this person. Etc. Right? Like, so, I mean, people make mistakes, right? So, it's not like I think she should be beheaded in public or something because she missed a diagnosis. Let's give her another chance. Gotta get changed on the story here first. I left a message there for her. I should get a call back in the next couple of days, I hope. I think they had a broader, I thought there was something structurally broken in there, you know, like a bone fragment or a misplaced joint or something like that, and telling me that my nerves are all tangled up with my blood vessels is kind of, it's in the right category, right? So, but like I say, there's no use in going into a doctor's office and gloating, you know, like, she went to school a lot longer than I did. She's gonna know things overall, but I mean, at the same time, like, I know my body better, you know? Like, it's kind of crazy when somebody walks in and they tell you, when somebody walks into your office and they tell you that they're having symptoms, it's kind of crazy to tell them that they're not, right? So, I mean, like, I pushed for the scans that came back, you know, like, I'm right that I realized I was having symptoms of something, like, what am I even gloating about, you know, like, it's ridiculous. I should have never had to prove that I'm experiencing symptoms, right? That's something that a doctor should take you on good faith for, so. It's not like I'm gloating that I'm right and she's wrong. It's more like she didn't do her job right. Right? Like it's not an ego thing. It's more just like a lack of good competence in what she was doing. But I don't want to walk in there and rub it in her face. Like I just want to get an understanding. Of what my options are moving forward. Hopefully I get a response in the next couple of days. And we can go deal with that. So that was, another loose end. And, I'm still not going to sleep, even though I'm obviously pretty, pretty broken right now. Okay, so the next group of things I need to do is on the machine. It's gonna be, I need to close this window by running through some tabs. And as I run through each tab, I'll remember what I'm doing in each one. This is going to be include writing a journal entry on my music vlog. I'm going to need to update the shipping price in the records that are available to ship. And I'm going to close the discs. So let me run through this as I go. And there's this NBC pool that people are a little bit upset about because it has Clinton up by 14 points. People are saying that's crazy. There's no way. Well, let's read the poll together. And let's try to understand what it actually says. First of all, it doesn't have her up by 14. It has her up by 11. Because there are not two candidates running, there are three candidates running. I have to say that I don't even know why they bother with the head-to-head question, because it's not predictive. You're asking a question in a reality that doesn't exist. There's not two people running, there's three people running. In fact, there's more than three people running. But, unfortunately, it seems like we don't want to... I would like to say that Stein is doing better than she is, but she's not. There's three people running, okay? So there's no reason to guffaw at a 14-point lead, because there's not a 14-point lead. It's an 11-point lead. Okay? Now, this is also a small sample size with a 5% margin of error. It's a little bit less. I rounded it up a bit. It was like 4.6 or something. So the poll doesn't say she's winning by 11 points. It says that there's a 95% chance, I'm presuming a confidence interval. They might have done it at 90. They might have done it at 99. I think that they probably either did it at 90 or 95 with a sample size that small. It might only be 90%, guys, but probably 95% chance that she's winning by somewhere between 6 and 16 points. And gee, that's not a very strong statement, really, is it? If you actually understand what the poll says. I know people want to look at the poll and they say, the poll says there's a 100% chance that she's winning by 14 points. That's not what the poll said. What the poll said is that there's a 90-some percent chance that she's somewhere between 6 and 16 points ahead. And that's not a controversial statement. I'd bet the house on that. It's important that media personalities know how to read the polls, if they're going to be commenting on them. Alright? You want to be a media person and not talk about politics, then I don't care if you know numbers or not. But this is a part of your job. I've done this before. I'm going to call on the major media networks to please put their personalities through basic numeracy courses. I know that their job is not to be a statistician. Their job is to be a personality. Nobody tunes in to watch the statistician in the morning. They tune in to watch the personality in the morning. That's fine. But they gotta have some idea. This isn't really complicated. You can get this idea across in a couple of hours. Send them on a crash course. No, do it. Seriously, please. All of them. I'm not trying to pick anyone out, because this could be anyone could be this, right? I've seen it from a lot of people. They're journalists or other, you know, marketing people or whatever, right? Or even just celebrities. They didn't study stats in school. Although, you'd think maybe they should have. I can blame this on the schools too, right? If you're going to go through a journalism program, you should take a basic stats course. That should be a part of the program. I'm sorry. I don't know how you can argue with me. You know, tell me that a journalist shouldn't have a basic stats education. Of course they should. And if you can't figure out how to do basic statistics, you're not smart enough to be writing in a newspaper. I'm sorry. Maybe you can work as an editor. But if you're going to be writing papers,
Like, if you're writing columns, you'd better be smart enough to understand some basic numbers. Otherwise, your opinion is not very valuable. So first of all, let's get the media organizations to put people through these courses, because a lot of these people, they're celebrities. They don't even have journalism backgrounds, okay? But also, let's get the schools to put journalists. I'm not saying that you need to have a math degree or even a minor. If you take a psychology, you know, program or an economics there's a lot of math in economics, but if you take a psychology course and you graduate with a psychology degree, you take like a half credit per year in statistical methods, if that. You might be done after second year. Is that too much to ask of journalists who probably have 10 credits in breadth requirements? It's not. Make them take a credit or two worth of stats courses. And yes, that means that they'd have to pass grade 12 math. God forbid. That said, I've been clear for a while now that the polls we've been getting have been manipulated to manufacture a race. You should not be surprised that Clinton is pulling so far ahead. She was always very far ahead. The polls have been very stable. It's not the polling you're seeing now that's suspect. It's the polling you saw a few weeks ago that was. Okay? So you saw the race tighten and then you're surprised that it opened up. It never tightened, so it didn't open up. It was always, you know, big distance. She was up 5-6 points the whole time. There were just a lot of really bad polls published to fuck with your heads and make you think there was a race, and there wasn't. So don't be surprised that she's far ahead. Realize that you got tricked into thinking it was close in the first place. Do I really think she'd win by 11 points if there were an election today? It's not crazy, okay? 11 is a little, it's on the you know, high end, okay, sure. I was saying 3-7, and I said 3-7 for weeks, months. I think maybe that's inched up a little bit. Okay, it's not 3-7 anymore. Now it's 5-9, it's 6-10, and you're going to throw polls at me, and I'm going to throw them in the trash, okay? There's good polling, and there's bad polling. I don't want to read aggregates. I don't want to average out good and bad. When you average good with bad, you get mediocre. What's the point of that? So my reading of the polls was previously, you know, around 5, a bit higher. It's starting to look more like 5 is the bare minimum. If you've got a poll where she's coming in less than 5, you want to be iffy about that poll. The, you know, good polls are all, they're unanimous. She's more than 5 points ahead. 7 points ahead, 8 points ahead. Even the 538 aggregate, and I don't like aggregates because, like I say, when you take good data and you average it with bad data, you get mediocre data. Maybe we could talk about aggregates if we remove the bad data. And I know that the 538 is at least, he at least weights them, right? And that's better, but it's still, I don't see anything wrong with discriminating about the data you're using and saying, this sucks, I'm not using it. Even he's got her up by 7. And that's with bad data being used. She's winning by a substantial margin. And I'm sorry if you let sensationalist media convince you otherwise. Okay, so I have closed the tabs up. That window's closed. And that means the next task is to close these records. inri014 and inri015. It's been a long ways coming. I don't think I did any of these in the mirror. But I mean, I'm feeling okay. I haven't wiped my makeup yet from yesterday, so that'll probably be the next task, I suppose. inri014, It's a track called Schizoid. We may have talked a little bit about this at some point in, like, December. This was a track that I was trying to be weird. And that's really the best way to say it, is that I was just trying to be weird. What does that mean exactly? So, it was one of the earliest songs that I wrote. Well, I mean, not the earliest, like, there was stuff I wrote in, like, 93 or 94. Yeah, I think 94, I think, is this was more like 95-ish. When I say earliest, what I mean is, like, I had, it's one of the tracks that I had written out, by hand, on these, like, tab notation, things on paper. It was in the old house. It was actually written a lot around the multi-effects processor that I had bought that year for Christmas. So it would have been... I think I bought it the Christmas of 95, so I think that would have been... It would have been a 96-ish. Yeah, early 96-ish, I think. And if you listen to it carefully, you can hear that there's kind of a background noise effect with the effects pedal. I'm using the effects pedal as kind of a noise generator. It's almost like a synthesizer, or it's being used the way that a synthesizer would be used in music, even though, I mean, obviously it's not a synthesizer, right? And so I'm not using it like a synthesizer in the sense of generating, but the kind of sound effects would be almost more associated with synthesizers, generally speaking. And that's a big part of the track and the way it was based around, right? It was written around a guitar riff that I thought was really spooky, right? And so I'm playing it, and I remember playing it late at night, right, when I wrote it. So it would have been like, I don't know, 2 o'clock in the morning, something like that. Probably later than that, even. And it's dark, and in my room, and I'm just playing my guitar, and it's, you know, it is a creepy song, and I built the entire arrangement up around the premise that, okay, this is a creepy song, right? The lyrics came out of that. What are the lyrics about? The lyrics are about someone who's, like, stuck in their place and they can't get out because they're gonna blow up the world, and it's like, I'm 15 years old and I'm trying to, like, write a psychological, you know, I'm trying to write, like, an X-Files episode or something, right? And it, I don't know, if you enjoy it, I'd say it's a good couple of steps an abstraction above anything that I would write or listen to nowadays. I find the vocals quite painful. There is a certain level of the thing is, it's not real, right? I've stripped the vocals out entirely on the CD. So, you can still get the vocals, if you download, if you get the download, they come in as bonus tracks, right? But, not on the physical disc, not a part of the official release. They're painful. I was saying that, I mean, a lot of the tracks that came up, in that period might be a little bit cringy, but they're really real, right? So there's, like, the one about wanting to, like, cut off my own penis, going through, like insane transgendered emotions. There's one where I'm, like, mocking, you know, these douchebags that are all like, "Did your mom?" You know, and stuff like that. Really real, you know, and it might be hard to listen to, but it's real, right? This is not real at all. This is, I'm exploring some fantasy of mental illness. It may be even, there's an argument that it might even be considered offensive to certain kinds of
mental health advocates, right? It's just, it's not... I don't feel the same attachment to it that I felt to a lot of the other material, so I've kind of orphaned it. Schizoid is on the single inri 14, which I'm closing right now. It is attached to another track, which was initially called Terrorists on the demo tape. It's called it was called Midwestern Playland on the initial CD. I renamed it to MWP, and this track very much the same kind of thing. The vocals, actually, the initial version of it was like a song about terrorism, and it was just like the worst political analysis you could imagine. I'm only 15 years old. I don't understand what the hell I'm saying. I'm being like brainwashed by Bono, and it's just like I'm really not mentally advanced enough to have a articulate discussion about this particular topic, even though I no doubt thought that I was. One thing that's interesting, I was expecting that, I saw it come up. I just hope these aren't my bad batteries. I think they are, unfortunately. I was saying, I pointed this out a few times, that one of the things that's interesting about this particular track is that it's about terrorism, but I'm talking about like abortion bombers in Ireland, right? Like, I'm talking about like the IRA and like the bomber at the 96 Olympics in Atlanta and that kind of stuff, right? Like, I'm not, like, there's no concept of Islamic terrorism in my mind, and you have to really separate that out of your head, okay? This is about Christian extremism, like, very explicitly. The topic of the song is Christians, not like communist, not like anarchist agitation type terrorism, specifically extremist Christian terrorism, which in 1996 was the only terrorism that really existed. There was a little bit of, there were bombings in the Middle East, but they were in the Middle East, right? That's where those bombings happened, was always in the Middle East. All the extremist terrorism in the United States and Canada and Europe was carried out by Christians. You kind of actually scratch your head and wonder what happened, right? But that was the truth of it. And to this day, my initial reaction is always, you know, fucking Christians, whenever I see an attack. Still. Because, I mean, that's what was implanted in my mind. It's just another reason why I'm not a fucking millennial, okay? That's gotta be very Gen X. When we think of terrorists, we think of Christians. So that's something to kind of keep in mind. But, I mean, those vocals were stripped out. Like, they were left on the demo. When I did it for the CD, I replaced it with, these are just total, like, random. Like, I don't even have a story as to what they were about. That's how random they were. They were just totally random, right? And what ended up happening is that in both cases, I put these two songs, they were connected with a sig. On the demo tape, they were connected with a guitar and bass cover of Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness, just because I thought it would sound cool. I thought it would sound cool on guitar, right? And, you know, if you're going to do it on guitar, then it kind of makes sense to, you can do some kind of accompaniment. There's a bottom end, I had a bass, so that's what I did it with, right? And actually, it's a little bit messy, but I think it actually came out pretty well. On the CD, there's like an experimental techno thing in the middle. I'm using a 909 emulator. It's called Hammerhead. If you're an old software geek, this was 98, and I was running Windows 95 at the time. In fact, I don't know when Windows 98 came out, but I didn't have it yet. I was still, was still running Windows 95 for sure. Which is something to keep in mind, right? My first record was initially done entirely on Windows 95. In fact, my second record was done entirely on Windows 95 too. I didn't switch over to 98 until like, well, sometime in 1999, you know. Yeah. I switched over to 98 when I got a new computer in like late 1999. My entire first period, musically speaking, which is like the first like 30 some releases, are all in Windows 95. No joke. Yeah, so I mean, I'm messing around with a hammerhead, sort of with a 909 emulator there, and it's just this, you know. But the point is that I had these two songs in both circumstances. They were one after the other, except separated by a SIG, and it led me to the conclusion that wait a second, I can build a single off of this, and the kind of lack of conceptual unity, so the lack of interesting conceptual material for both discs kind of put that together, right? And that's how we ended up doing that. So I don't have really a story for this one, other than that there isn't a story, and that, like I said, the first one was really just like total throwaway. Like, there was really, like, the first version of it was just like trying to be political and not really understanding what I'm saying, and probably in my mind thinking that, like, this is what's cool, is to be, you know, like a political liberal, and like I'm cool because I'm writing a song saying that, like, you know, that abortion bombers suck, right? And I'm 15 years old, okay? I could have written a song about, you know, I could have written Mbop. Instead, I wrote a song trying to discuss, you know, the IRA. It doesn't come off so well. Maybe it comes off better than Mbop. I don't know. But, and when I redid it, it was just, like, total, I can't even make sense of it. It was just, like, random words, stream of consciousness, just pulled words out of my ass. There's no thought to it at all, right? Which was actually the case of a lot of songs on the first demo. When I redid them, I pulled out the ones that seemed to kind of maybe mean something more to me, and I left a lot of the stream of consciousness stuff there. This is kind of maybe the exception in that sense, in that I actually took a song that maybe did have a little bit of thought behind it, and then I turned it into stream of consciousness. Either way, I don't, like, there's nothing there. There's nothing to really talk about. There's no lyrical meaning to it at all. Musically, it's an interesting guitar part. Actually, I should point that out too. The first part of that, the terrorist part, and I put it together, it's Schizoid Terrorist. You know, it's kind of... It's just because those were the names of the songs. There's no meaning besides that, right? The first song was called Terrorist, the second one was called Schizoid. You put it together, it's Schizoid Terrorist, and, you know, the conservatives throw things at you, and... It's okay, right? So yeah, I mean, this was another song that I had written out on paper, off to the side, for quite a while, and I built it up like that, right? And so, and if you listen to it from a musical perspective, and in fact, this is something that like, it upsets me, it upset me for a long time, because this is actually one of the... Like, musically speaking, it's one of the more interesting tracks on the first record, but the vocals were just so bad that I couldn't do anything with it. I got the vocals out now, and it's back to being kind of one of my favorite tracks. But I mean, it's purely musical, right? There's the only way you can get the vocal version, either the initial one or the redone one. The only way you can get that is if you download them as bonus material. It's not on the signal proper. It's not on the physical version either. All that's left there is a couple of different instrumental versions. Same thing with Schizoid, actually. It's the same thing. Ooh, excuse me. With Terrorists, It was it's a really neat drum machine part with this kind of lush keyboard fantasy. I got to sleep at some point. Kind of lush keyboard harmonies. That's the word I'm looking for there. With Schizoid, it's meant to be really creepy and unnerving and scary sounding. That's what I'm looking for here. I'm gonna use the word romantic, even though it's not at all. But it's a really like nihilistic violin part that comes in. And it gets all like serious Wagnerian, it's all meant to sound like really scary, right? Like unsettling, creepy, weird shit. That's the song. And when you put them together, I think there's something really. It's become one of my favorite pieces, but purely musically speaking. I don't have a story. All I have is what it is musically. That's it. So, yeah. Inri 14 closed without saying anything that there isn't anything to say. Which brings me to the record, Inri 15. It is now closed permanently. And that actually is kind of an important, meaningful thing to me. This is my first disc, initially created sometime in mid-1998. I've got it dated to June 20th, but that's revisionist. I can't, maybe by luck I happen to be right, but I can't say for sure what day I finished it on. It would have been, within a week, one way or the other. It was somehow around the 20th of June, right? It was there with, so I finished it and then I compressed it and then I burned the compressed MP3s and then I deleted the WAV files. So the only document I have had of my first record for years and years was a CDR that I burned, and these were low quality MP3s, okay? 56 to 112 kbps MP3s. It was a very stupid thing of me to do, but I ended up stuck with it, and there wasn't any way out of it. What I've done is I have remastered all of that stuff from scratch. I have removed all the vocals, removed a lot of samples, revamped certain things. It's a remaster, remix, reinterpretation, reversion. But this needs to be its final resting place because it's done now. I don't want the record to be connected to its lyrical forerunner. Okay? We talked about all of the different lyrical concepts that were on the record, right? We talked about all those things. And they're not on the record. It's completely instrumental. So we don't want to bring those ideas onto the record, right? What's in the singles stays in the singles. The record is a lengthy piece of electronic music, instrumental electronic music, and that I would like you to consume the same way you would consume an Aphex Twin record. It's not quite abstract enough to be Autarker, but it's broadly speaking, it's IDM, okay? And that's what it is, and that's how I want you to think of it. I don't want you to think of it as, like shock rock or grunge or industrial music, because it's not anymore. When I take the vocals out and the way I've revamped it, it's just instrumental electronic music, and it's meant to be taken that way. And I think the fact that I'm here at this point, that I've gotten over to this, it's just super important to me. Because I've reclaimed it now, right? there used to be a point in time, I mean, there still is, right? Those first two demos are quarantined. They're in a special spot in my discography, right? It used to be that pretty much everything before, like, 2000 was in that category, right? But I've been slowly, over the last couple of years, reclaiming a lot of that stuff. And to have my entire first record as it was essentially created, more or less, the differences are very minor and largely aesthetic, right? So I couldn't recreate the version of the end part of Skits White that was on the record. I just redid it. And it sound like, you know, like, it's not identical, but like it what's there fills the purpose the way it's supposed to. It's as good as it's as good as new, in my opinion, right? As good as brand new. And like I said, it's so massively, you know, it's like you found something that you thought you lost, right? I thought I lost this 20 years ago, and then I found it, right? Something really important to you, something that was, like, you know, super key, you know, and you find it, and you're like, whoa, there you are, right? That's kind of what that's about. I'm closing a record here. I'm supposed to be, you know, talking about it. I don't want to do that. If you want to know about the conceptual concepts or the ideas behind the different songs, in fact, every single song has a single. I ensured that was the case, so that any of the tracks that you're interested in, there's a write-up and a single for it. The only exception are a couple of the segs, and even so, it's not many of them. The only really serious exception is there's a cover of The Phantom of the Opera, but it's the cover of The Phantom of the Opera. And even that's a part of a single. You know, it's part of Inri 13. In fact, let me think here. There's only one track that can't be found elsewhere. But in fact, that... Yeah. Okay. Two tracks will show up. There's going to be a single for the track War, eventually. And the track Swim doesn't have... Swim is nowhere else, but it will be. It will be on a student project I did in that for grade 12. I took a course in electronic music in grade 12, and I did a student project, and it'll show up there. So, literally, eventually everything on the record will have a write-up on one of the other things. Every single track. Go consult them there. On this record, it's just music. Just interpreted as music. No concepts, no analysis. Just put those headphones on and lose yourself in the sound. Sound art. Entirely, nothing more to it than that. That's my write-up. That's my close. That's what I want it to be. And let's carry on. Okay, so we still have quite a few different loose ends to do. The next thing that I'm going to be doing in here is some editing. Specifically, I'm going to watch a bunch of videos. That's the reason I closed the tab down, was so that I could open up my editing tab. I gotta watch vlogs from like the 5th, the 6th, and the 7th, and then upload them. Is that when I'm gonna crash? Depends how hungry I get. That's the honest truth. Okay, so, yeah. Next step in this day that doesn't end is, to watch the vlogs from the last couple of days. Actually, it's not from the last couple of days. You know what? It is last, because this is such a long day that it is the last couple of days. How about that? It's starting to get dark already. How about that? Craziness. I wash my face instead. I'm about to get started watching the vlogs. But we're going to multitask. Next odds and ends thing to do is going to be
to make some pasta. I don't know if I'm going to eat tonight or not, but I think we could at least get the pasta going. It's also a little cold in here, which is frustrating to me because it's actually a nice day out. It's like 18 degrees out, right? Well, I'm sure it's come down a little bit now, but it was nice this afternoon, and like I guess they're just refusing to heat the upstairs. So if they're gonna refuse to heat the upstairs, I don't have any choice but to, again, the hot air is going to escape, right? If I'm the only person with the heat on, then all the heat's gonna, it's all gonna throw out of here. And what they're thinking in their head is that I don't have to turn the heat on because they have the heat, you know. I don't have to turn the heat on because the tenant in the basement has the heat on. No, it's the opposite. If you turn your heat on, then I will turn my heat on less because the heat upstairs will act as a buffer. If you're not going to turn your heat on at all, I have to heat the whole building. And then I'm going to turn it up really high. And I'm using the most expensive type of heat. So it's going to cost you the most. I actually did explain this to them. Anyways, we don't need to complain about that all night. Let's just get the let's just get the spaghetti running here. And like I said, I don't know if I'm gonna eat tonight, but I want to at least have the spaghetti done. So if I do, and I am pretty hungry, I'm kind of getting there.